Our story begins with Grandma Dunn. She was born Roseanne Corrigan in County Westmeath, Ireland, in 1827. She fled her homeland because of the potato famine in 1843 and arrived in Milwaukee, Wisconsin. There, she married James Dunn, moved to Cedarsburg, Wisconsin, and raised 8 children, eventually relocating to Kinross, Iowa, in 1876. In 1891, her youngest daughter, also named Roseanne, married Tim O'Brien, who with his father Patrick ran a farm implement and lumber business in town. Tim and Roseanne were blessed with 8 children, and on April 15th, 1904, their youngest boy was born. He was baptized Leo Lawrence O'Brien. Leo's father was the first mayor of Kinross, a small farming community in southeastern Iowa. They were a committed Irish Catholic family, and when it came time to build the new Sacred Heart Church, Tim donated the lumber at cost. Leo was described by those who knew him then as being a kid whose sense of humor could make even his grade school teachers laugh. He graduated from high school in 1921, worked his grandmother's farm with his uncle Bill Dunn, and then moved to Marcus, Iowa in 1924, where he found employment in his brother Mike's restaurant. Sioux City, In 1926, he moved to Sioux City and worked for the Milwaukee Railroad. It was in Sioux City that he became a registered and lifelong Democrat, and it was also in that Midwestern town that he met the lovely Eileen Carpenter, a young lady that his older brother Jimmy had once dated. He was smitten, asked her to marry him, and they were wed on a cold February morning in 1928. Eileen's sister and brother-in-law, Joe and Toots Kern, are the best man and maid of honor. The flower girls are Helene and Bunny Ryan, and the ring boy is Donald O'Neill. Their first son, John, is born the following November. 11 months later, the stock market crashes. 4 months after the stock market crashes, their second son, Bill, is born. Because of the Depression, Leo loses his job and is forced to move in with Eileen's mother and sisters. He is 26 years old, married, the father of 2 children, and without a job. Eileen has a job cleaning offices in the evening and hears about an opening for a salesman at Prudential Insurance. Leo lands the job, is an excellent salesman, and in a few years, leads his region in policy sold. He moves his family into their own place, and they live these years surrounded by O'Briens and Carpenters. They take family vacations, make Budweiser the official beer of choice because Uncle Ray McNulty drives their delivery trucks, and survive the waning years of the Depression in the Midwest. The boys attend parochial school and are raised in the Catholic faith. If there was ever a man who loathed cold winters, it was Leo. In 1941, he traveled to California with 2 of Eileen's sisters, Mildred and Leona, who are considering a move to the West. He is never the same and becomes obsessed with moving there himself. He tries to get Prudential to transfer him, but is unable to. That same year, Eileen becomes pregnant, gives birth to a baby girl, Mary Catherine, who dies within hours of her birth. In the wake of this pivotal event, Leo continues to campaign for a West Coast transfer, but is unsuccessful. However, in the spring of 1942, an opportunity in Denver, Colorado is offered, and he accepts it. It is June of 1942, and the United States is about 6 months into World War II.
Oh, give me land, lots of land under starry skies above. Don't fence me.
Leo is 38, Eileen 36, and John and Bill are 13 and 12, respectively, when they arrive. Bill finishes the 8th grade, and John starts high school in the Mile High City. There are relatives on both sides of the family already living there, so again, they are surrounded by loved ones. Leo does well with Prudential But the altitude and weather doesn't agree with him. The taste of California has spoiled him forever. He had a perpetual case of the sniffles all of his life and had hoped to find relief in warmer weather. Finally, an opportunity does open up in Southern California in 1944, and as soon as school was out, the Leo O'Brien family was off to the West.
Oh, I'm packing my grill, and I'm leaving today, 'cause I'm taking a trip California way.
In the middle of World War II, and 1 year after the Zoot Suit Riots in Los Angeles, the O'Briens relocate to a place called Montebello. The boys are now 15 and 14. Several of Leo's first cousins on the Dunn side of the family had migrated there from South Dakota during the Dust Bowl years. As well, three of Eileen's sisters had been living in the LA area for some time, Gertrude, Mildred, and Leona. Leo begins to work for Prudential, but is intrigued by a business venture that is pitched to him by the husband of one of his cousins, Dean Swiden. Swiden and O'Brien Appliances open on Whittier Boulevard in Montebello shortly after the war.
Would you like to swing on a star? Carry moonbeams home in a jar and be better off than you are.
They specialize in commercial refrigeration, though they also sell radios, toasters, washing machines, home refrigerators, and a new invention called television. Leo becomes a prominent and successful businessman in his town. They advertise on the local TV station. He's a member of the Lions Club. He bowls, he golfs, he shoots pool, and plays gin rummy with his pals. He rides horses in the local parade. He's a member of the Knights of Columbus and Holy Name Society at St. Benedict's Parish. The family moves to a duplex on Taylor Avenue. He is the quintessential Irish Catholic Democrat businessman and proud of it. The boys first attend Cathedral High School and then transfer to Montebello High the following year, where they each graduate in their respective years, 1946 and 1947. John is in a serious car accident in 1945 with a Dunn cousin and has a plate inserted into his forehead. Bill enlists in the Marine Corps in 1948, does his time, and is discharged until Korea begins. The appliance store continues to prosper, and in 1949, Leo and Eileen purchased their first home at 460 Via Miramonte. Their eldest son, John, marries Grace Sechrist in June of 1950 with the wedding at St. Benedict's and the reception at the new house. Bill returns to the service as the Korean War heats up, and Leo is diagnosed with diabetes. The first of nine grandchildren, Mike, is born in 1952. These were the prosperous years. Eileen had begun working at the V&S Pharmacy in East Los Angeles in the early 50s. There were lots of backyard gatherings and regular vacations with friends. In those days, their cars were either Mercurys or Fords. Bill marries Dolores Eccleston in 1953, and their first son, Billy, is born the following year. There is a new grandchild nearly every year until 1962, 10 in all, including baby Eileen, who died shortly after her birth. The sons eventually buy homes on the same street in South Montebello. The appliance business prospers until the mid-50s, when Leo and his business partner have a falling out, and the store closes in 1957 after a decade's worth of prosperity. He is 53 years old, and without a job. He sells insurance for the Knights of Columbus, attends Catholic men's retreats, and takes the pledge to abstain from alcohol for a season. This is perhaps one of the darkest periods of his life. His role as grandfather, however, seemed to delight him. He enjoyed dropping by the neighborhood and often picked us up from school on rainy days. He always had candy and orange juice in his car in case of a diabetic reaction. There are lots of great memories around Christmas time, birthday dinners, and summer barbecues during this period. In 1960, he begins working as a salesman for Ostrom Chevrolet in Montebello and is relatively successful at this job for a Ford man. Having passed the real estate exam, Leo began to work for Herman Realty in 1963. His office was on Whittier Boulevard, near his grandkids' school, so we dropped in on our way home from time to time. He always gave us change to buy a donut at Winchell's. He was not wildly successful in real estate, but he did fine and worked there until 1963. The same year that Leo went into real estate, his wife Eileen decided to purchase an organ for their home, hoping to learn herself and perhaps inspire some of the grandkids to learn. Daughter-in-law Grace played almost immediately, and grandson Mike took an inordinate interest. This instrument begins to provide the soundtrack to every family gathering from this time on. Nobody enjoys singing with his family more than Leo, especially his favorite tune, Minnie the Mermaid. In 1967, he bought a 64 Cadillac, and he thought he died and went to heaven. The side of the house would never be the same. By 1971, his health is beginning to decline. He's carrying more weight than he should and not remembering things like he used to. He quits his real estate job in 1972, and by 1975, he doesn't drive as a result of suffering several mild strokes. Still functioning fairly well, Eileen continues to work at the pharmacy. The family drops in more often to look in on him and visit. He cries a lot at family gatherings, especially when we all sing, but seems to enjoy having us all around nonetheless. By 1977, he suffers a more severe stroke and is hospitalized. Eileen's time at the pharmacy winds down, and in 1978, he attends grandson Mike's wedding and part of the reception. That same year, he also enjoys holding his first great-grandchild, Jacqueline Dixon, Tim and Colleen's daughter. He becomes severely ill toward the end of the year and passes away in November of 1978. His funeral was well attended, and family traveled from Iowa, Colorado, and Oregon to pay their respects. At the time of his death, only three sisters survived him: Rose, Teresa, and Agnes. I titled this piece, The Lion and the Lamb, because that's how I think about my grandfather these days. I saw both traits evidenced in him from time to time, but the Grandpa Leo role that he was born to play always leaned more in the direction of the Lamb. Driving with a beer between his legs, tipping his hat when he passed the parish church, dancing in his bedroom slippers, tearing up when any of us sang a song he liked, buying tacos for lunch on Sunday afternoons, and a million other things break into my consciousness regularly and produce a very unique kind of joy. Mostly, he was a huge presence who made a significant difference in the grandkids that he so delighted in. With Pat, Bill, Colleen, Jay, Tim, Mary, Tom, and Katie, I am grateful to God for the gift that he was to all of us. I hope this film will serve to keep the memories alive for a few more generations.
In the morning sun, and when the night is new, I'll be looking at the moon. be seeing you.
Last night, I dreamed that I was down in the bottom of the sea, down in that salty water. And I met a maiden fair who had a cottage there. Of course, she didn't have it in her own name, but anyway, we had it. And she had a tale of a fish for a train, but whoa, now whoa, how that gal could entertain. And what a time I had with Minnie, the mermaid, down at the bottom of the sea. I lost all my troubles in amongst the bubbles. Why, she was just as sweet as she could be. And every night when those starfish came out, I hugged and kissed her so. Oh, oh, what a time I had with Minnie, the mermaid, down in her seaweed bungalow, low, down in her seaweed bungalow. Yeah, I can't forget those happy days way down at the bottom of the sea. Yeah, I'm strong for her, and I really long for her, and I'm inclined to believe that she's longing for me. So every night, I'm in bed before 9, because I want to dream again of that mermaid of mine. Because, oh, what a time I had with Minnie, the mermaid, down at the bottom of the sea.